It is also a form of madness for black people to imitate their oppressors. Yet they strongly desire not only to dress like them, but to look like them in order to be accepted in the dominant society. But it still does not work out that way. Black people remain in a deep state of spiritual blindness, not conscious of the path that points to their origin and creator. So they embrace the religion, doctrines, and culture of the slave master. So they embrace the religion, doctrines, and culture of the slave master. So they embrace the religion, doctrines, and culture of the slave master. All four of Ham's sons and their descendants settled in and around the continent of Africa. This includes the so-called Middle East, which is also part of the continent of Africa. Ham's sons are the people of the African continent, the ancient Egyptians, Ethiopians, Somalias, Canaanites, etc. The Israelites are descendants of Noah's son Shem through Abraham. He is the father of the Hebrew Israelite nation. Abraham is the father of Isaac. Isaac is the father of Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, and these sons are the patriarchs of the Israelite nation. The 12 tribes of Israel are as follows: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Dan, Gad, Asher, Naphtali, Zebulun, Issachar, Joseph, Benjamin.
The children of Israel were the children of Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. Jacob's name was changed to Israel because he had an encounter with an angel. Okay? In the land of Canaan, where they lived, there was a famine in the land of Canaan. One of Jacob's sons, who was Yosef, which we call today Joseph, Yosef was sold as a slave into Egypt. Being a Hebrew Israelite, he served Yahweh. He trusted Yahweh because that's what he was brought up to love and serve Yahweh. He trusted Yahweh. And because while he was in Egypt of his faithfulness to Yahweh, he won favor with Pharaoh and all the people of Egypt. And so when Pharaoh had a dream and could not interpret the dream, they called for Joseph. And Joseph came and he interpreted the dream, and he made it explicitly clear to the king that we're going to have some years of plenty, we're going to have some years of drought. He said, but you know what, the years of plenty, if we take all that we harvest and store it up, we will have enough to take us through the lean years. And the king was so pleased. He said, Yosef, you're going to be in charge of all this, taking care of all this and see that this is done. And while Yosef was there, his brothers forgot all about him because they sold him. And their father didn't realize that Yosef was still alive, because they went home and lied to their father and said, a wild beast killed him. But Yosef, his heart, his mind, everything was serving Yahweh. And he won favor. And his favor is what caused him to be able to reunite with his father and his brothers. His brothers, when they came down to get food, Yosef immediately knew it was his brothers, but they couldn't recognize him. Why? Because he was now dressed in an Egyptian apparel. They're black. Black people. He recognized his people.
Obadiah Yisrael of the Hebrew Israelites in Chicago points out that if Joseph and the Hebrews look like Donny Osmond, who portrayed Joseph in a stage play, his brothers would have recognized him easily among the black Egyptians. But Joseph's own flesh and blood brothers thought he was an Egyptian. The ancient Egyptians of Joseph's time were indeed what we know today as black. This is a fact attested to by many.
When Yosef became governor of Egypt, and he went to Pharaoh after making acquaintance with his brothers, went to Pharaoh and told Pharaoh, look, my family, my dad, my brothers, they all I want to bring them here because they're suffering over there. And Pharaoh was just happy to get Joseph's family down into Egypt. And these were Pharaoh's words: bring them and we will give them the best in Egypt. Hallelujah. And so Joseph, Pharaoh sent carts to transport Joseph's father, his brothers, his wives, their wives and their children. There were 66 people in all that left Canaan and went to Egypt. Hallelujah. But what happened is, while Joseph was there, he was the favorite to all of Egypt and all the nations around. Everybody knew Joseph because he was the man next to the king. And when the brothers came and they all settled there, after Pharaoh died, the new king did not know anything about Joseph. He did not know Joseph. So he didn't take to Joseph very quickly. And so Joseph had problems with him. He had problems with Joseph, in that he found that these Hebrew people were multiplying too fast. So he says, you know what? We're going to do this. These people might just overrun us. They might become more than us and then join with our nations next door, and they will overrun us. They'll take us over. So he instructed the midwives. He said, every Hebrew woman that is pregnant and sit on the birthing stool, you make sure, you look and make sure that that child is not a male. If it's a male child, kill it, but let the female live. And the birthing women couldn't do it because Yahweh's spirit was in them. And they allowed the boys to be born and the girls to be born. And the king got angry. And he got angry and he says, no, they're multiplying faster than we are. So let us enslave them. That's how slavery began. That's where it all began. It began with those children of Israel. And Israel was Jacob's name, who was changed to Israel.
This is a historical depiction of the Jews during the Babylonian period, clearly showing the African racial origins that many believe originated out of Egypt and was followers of the Akhenaten religion. This is a statue of the boy king, King Tut. This statue was found in his tomb among many of the treasures in Egypt during an archaeological excavation in 1922. Scholars say King Tut was on the throne of Egypt a few years before the Israelites' exodus. John R. Moore wrote that the white supremacists advocated that Jesus was white. The world has been presented with a white Jesus from the Roman Empire, when Augustus was the royal leader around 31 BC to AD 14. This Eurocentric Christian world knows nothing about the real Jesus from the tribe of Judah, the Ethiopian who spoke Aramaic. According to Hebrews 7:14, the tribe of Judah, from whom whence Jesus, or Yeshua, his Hebrew name, came, is a dark-skinned nation of people. However, as Europe prospered, it presented the global world with a white Jesus. Around the time when the Bible was being translated from Hebrew to Greek to Latin to English, Revelation 1:14 clearly states, his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. Jesus' head and hair were white like wool is merely referring to his hair texture. The only people on the face of the earth with hair of a woolly texture are known as those of the Negroid race, whose hair is in its natural state is like a wool of a lamb. If black people do not cut or comb their hair, it will eventually lock together and become woolly.
The word Jewish, the word Jew, was never and never is in the old original scriptures. As a matter of fact, again, if there's no J in the Hebrew alphabet, how could you get the word Jew, or Joseph, or Jeremiah, or Jehovah? It's impossible. It's highly impossible, you see. But here is how this the word Jew or Jewish came into being. If we go back and you see, everything that we say today is scripture based. Everything is in scripture. It's sad that many of us have not gone into the research to really get the stuff, but it is recorded in scripture. And it says, if we go back to the book of Genesis, let me see if I could.
For I bear record that they have zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Fiddler, Chicken George, Nigga, Coon, Steppin' Fitchin, Negro, Monkey. These are proverbs and byword labels of general rebuke that includes a characterization in the form of taunting insults and offensive names, all of which act as substitutes that conceal Israel's true identity. Deuteronomy 28:37, "And thou shalt become astonishment, a proverb, and a byword, among all nations whither the Lord shall lead thee." Deuteronomy 28:15, "But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee." God said Israel would become an object of scorn and disdain among all nations wherever they go. U.S. Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice had an emergency Mideast meeting in Israel to try and supposedly hammer out a ceasefire agreement with the nation that calls themselves Israel and the Lebanese government. During the U.S. Secretary of State's visit, she was ridiculed and characterized as a monkey who was giving birth to a monkey. Historians frequently reported the characterization of the black slaves as a subhuman species with an insatiable sexual appetite who lacked intelligence, character, and feelings. Also, the U.S. Supreme Court and the Constitution of the United States decreed and placed into law that the so-called Negro was three-fifths human, leaving two-fifths for something else. It could not have been beast, for the white man treated his horse, cat, and dog far better than the so-called Negro. My friends, as we stand here today, many Hebrews have been fooled and tricked by our tormentor in thinking that they have a part of this American experience called a dream. Our enemies show token kindness to us if we bring them comfort, entertainment, or financial gain. We confuse this with acceptance and friendship. However, what happens when you can no longer sing, dance, play, or run? What happens to you when your entertainment and market value is no longer wanted or needed? What happens to you when the masa has no more need for you to sing, dance, play, or run? Many so-called Negroes refuse to believe that the masa's children would ever repeat the sins of their ancestors. We believe this because we are not in our right mind. We are a spiritually drunk people, desperate to be loved by those whom the scriptures say hate us. Sing, dance, play, and run the so-called Negro for entertainment purposes only. One of the worst episodes in the slave's life was during the dreaded Middle Passage journey from West Africa to the Americas, where the conditions on the slave ships were horrifying, with between 200 and 400 captives crammed into the bottom of the ships. Zechariah 11:5, "Whose possessors slay them and hold themselves not guilty, and they that sell them say, Blessed be the Lord, for I am rich, and their own shepherds pity them not." White Americans coined the phrase Negro barbecues. They were carried out when white mobs set out to burn black Americans alive or burn their dead bodies after a lynching. This helped to strengthen the conviction that blacks were less than human or on the same level as the wild beast of the field. Newspapers even carried headlines like, "Colored Man Roasted Alive," while explaining in graphic detail the slow, systematic, agonizing death of the helpless victim. Crowds, including women and children, traveled for miles to witness this blood sport, with school administrators delaying classes to allow both male and female students to return from viewing these evil, horrendous acts of brutality. This is an image of Will Brown, accused and arrested for allegedly raping a white woman before being seized by a white mob that beat him unconscious, then filled him with over 1,000 bullets prior to burning his body in 1919. Deuteronomy 28:17, "And I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and you shall flee when none pursue you." Many of the so-called Negroes in this land have chosen to forget the great suffering of their Hebrew ancestors and have chosen to embrace and indulge themselves in the spoils of what slavery, lynching, racism, murder, and rape has profited this nation called America. The world is having a party on the blood of a forgotten people, and the children of the forgotten people will share in the plagues of the children of the oppressors if they remain in fellowship with this world. From 1880 to 1930, more than 3,500 blacks were lynched or executed, but no one has ever been convicted of any of these horrendous crimes. Nevertheless, this nation called America, that Dr. King knew was on fire and under God's ultimate judgment, told us that we must be firemen and put out the fire in the masses' house. 2 Thessalonians 2, 8-12, "And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom Yah shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause Yah shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." In a book entitled Two Nations, Black and White, Separate, Hostile, Unequal, by Professor Andrew Hacker, he writes, "Most whites will protest that they bear neither responsibility nor blame for the conditions blacks face. Neither they nor their forebearers ever owned slaves, nor can they see themselves as having held anyone back or down. Today, the younger generations of whites resent being held morally or financially responsible for the racial sins of their ancestors, even though as whites they still enjoy the inherited advantages and privileges of slavery. The lynching of black people was a brutal combination of racism and sadism used by whites to terrorize blacks in order to safeguard white supremacy. The accepted method used for lynching was hanging, shooting, or both. But sometimes more gruesome methods of physical torture were employed, like burning at the stake, maiming, dismemberment, and castration. They held themselves not guilty." Deuteronomy 28:63, "So the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you and to bring you to naught, and ye shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone." Mr. Habersham, who was a legislative trustee in Georgia in 1749, advocated for the introduction of slavery into Georgia. Quote, "Many of the poor slaves in America," he wrote, "have already been made freemen of the heavenly Jerusalem. Their friends in Germany assured the slave masters of the so-called Negro that it was harmless to own slaves. If you take slaves in faith and with the intent of conducting them to Christ, the action will not be a sin, but may prove a benediction. So it was that avarice subdued conscience. Already slaves had been introduced into Georgia from South Carolina as hired servants under indentures for life or for 99 years. And at Savannah, the continual toast was, the one thing needful, which meant Negro slaves. Slavery was introduced on the condition that all masters should be obliged to compel the Negroes to attend at some time of the Lord's Day for instruction in the Christian religion. In 1752, the charter was surrendered to the crown. The colony had all the privileges accorded to others and flourished. Keep in mind that the King and the Queen of England are Catholic and held that the Lord's Day was Sunday and that those who owned slaves would instruct them on this day. However, Yah commanded that his people worship on the Sabbath, which is Saturday. Once again, we find ourselves agreeing and worshiping on the day that our tormentor and former colonial slave masters commanded us to worship. My friends, obedience to Yah's word is better than any sacrifice you may present to him. The question must be asked, who in their right mind would assist a murderer, kidnapper, child molester, and rapist? Only but the delusional so-called Negro. The very history of America identifies itself as the spawn of Satan, the adversary of the Almighty, the Antichrist, the Beast, and the Great Whore, spoken about in the book of Revelation. We as a people have certainly fulfilled Dr. King's fears, for we have certainly been integrated into a burning house, and the children of the Almighty are called to lead the evacuation. Deuteronomy 28:15. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Cursed shalt thou be in the city, and cursed shalt thou be in the field. These verses indicate that Israel will not be able to avoid these curses that will plague them wherever they settle. Ron R. Moore points out that during chattel slavery, which means movable personal property, the living conditions in the fields were more suited for animals, but slaves had to live under these extremely dehumanizing conditions, which robbed them of their humanity, labor, security, and their lives. More than a third of the black population in cities like Boston, New York, and Philadelphia lived in blind alleys, cellars, and lofts. The poor, unsanitary living conditions caused widespread health problems and shortened their lifespans. Deuteronomy 28:19. Cursed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shalt thou be when thou goest out. Verse 20. The Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke, and all that thou settest thine hand unto for to do, until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly, because of the wickedness of thy doings whereby thou hast forsaken me. Every attempt by black people in the Caribbean, the Americas, the United Kingdom, to improve their living conditions through the political, educational, and economic systems has been a failure. But at the same time, other ethnic racial groups have been successful in leading their people to an acceptable standard of living using those same systems. It is interesting to note that black Americans have been in the United States longer than most of the other ethnic groups, except the Native American Indian, but have still fallen behind every group in virtually every level of society. Leviticus 26:33, And I will scatter you among the heathen, and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste. Deuteronomy 28:25, The Lord shall curse thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them, and flee seven ways before them, and thou shalt be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. God declares that Israel would be forcibly removed from their ancestral homeland and scattered throughout the four corners of the earth as captives to these new lands, where they will dwell in the midst of people from all ethnicities, but not as a sovereign nation. This is another characteristic of the Israelites. This pronouncement could not refer to them who call themselves Israelis, since they have been able to defeat their enemies in every military battle since 1948, winning the 1948-49 and 1956 wars, the 1967 preemptive Six-Day War against the combined military forces of Egypt, Iraq, Jordan, and Syria, in addition to the 1973 Yom Kippur War. They successfully invaded Lebanon, seizing Jerusalem, the Golan Heights, the West Bank, Sinai, and more from their enemies. This certainly does not depict the modern Jews as being destroyed by their enemies. The latter section of verse 25 declares that Israel shall be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. To be removed means to be moved by force, and this is exactly what Israel's enemies did to the blacks of the Western Hemisphere. They were forcibly removed, stolen, and kidnapped from the west coast of Africa and transported to Europe, the Americas, and the Caribbean islands. Leviticus 26:33, And I will scatter you among the heathen, and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste. Deuteronomy 28:25, The Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them, and flee seven ways before them, and shalt be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. My friends, we as a people did not immigrate to all kingdoms of the earth voluntarily, as other immigrants have done. We were taken, removed into all kingdoms of the earth. Other ethnic groups, including those who say they are Jews, have migrated to the Western Hemisphere between the 17th and 20th centuries of their own free will and were not forcibly abducted, chained together, and scattered like wild animals. Deuteronomy 28:28, The Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart. A study found that black populations have an admission rate to mental institutions seven times higher than their white counterparts, or about 28 per every 100,000 as compared to 4 per every 100,000 for white people. It is also a form of madness for black people to imitate their oppressors, yet they strongly desire not only to dress like them, but to look like them in order to be accepted in the dominant society. But it still does not work out that way. Black people remain in a deep state of spiritual blindness, not conscious of the path that points to their origin and creator. So they embrace the religion, doctrines, and culture of the slave master, totally forgetting that it was under the authority of this religion that they were enslaved. They are therefore astonished at this state of madness and blindness and continue to ponder why they are the most hated race on earth and the target of such extreme racism. The Stockholm Syndrome comes into play when a captive cannot escape and is isolated and threatened with death, but is shown token acts of kindness by the captor. It typically takes about 3 or 4 days for the psychological shift to take hold. A strategy of trying to keep your captive happy in order to stay alive becomes an obsessive identification with the likes and dislikes of the captor, which has a result of warping your own psyche into such a way that you come to sympathize with your tormentor. Deuteronomy 28:29, "And thou shalt grope at noonday, as the blind gropeth in darkness, and thou shalt not prosper in thy ways, and thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore, and no man shall save thee." This verse stresses that Israel will be searching around in a blind stupor looking for a solution that would help them escape the predicament. Henry Barry, a United States Senator, once told the Virginia House of Delegates in 1832, "We have as far as possible closed every avenue by which the light may enter the slave's mind. If we could extinguish the capacity to see the light, our work would be complete. They would then be on the level with the beast of the field." Deuteronomy 28:32, "Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hand." Even after planting the vineyards and other crops, they were not permitted to enjoy any of the fruit. So the black Hebrew Israelites to this day and their children have never been compensated for providing all that free labor for over 400 years, which made America the world power as it is today. The Middle Passage also saw the transportation of the slaves to the West Indies, where they were exchanged for spices, rum, molasses, and sugar. The families of black Hebrew Israelites were destroyed during the long dreaded period of the transatlantic slave trade. Joel 3:3-6, "And they have cast lots for my people, and have given a boy for a harlot, and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have you sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border." Remember what Thomas Jefferson wrote to King George, that these people whom we have enslaved have done no wrong to us and have come from a far place from another hemisphere. The Almighty Yah is beginning to wake us up out of our slumber. Deuteronomy 28:32, "Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hand." Even in modern times, the children of black Hebrew Israelites continue to be taken away from their parents and placed in foster care and child welfare services. Deuteronomy 28:34, "So that thou shalt be mad for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see." For 4 centuries, the historical experience of black people have been molded by the turbulent periods of slavery, dehumanization, segregation, discrimination, racism, and even the pursuit of civil rights. Deuteronomy 28:36, "The Lord shall bring thee and thy king, which thou shalt set over thee, unto a nation which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, and there shalt thou serve other gods, wood and stone." Deuteronomy 28:41, "Thou shalt beget sons and daughters, but thou shalt not enjoy them, for they shall go into captivity, and they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever." Please keep in mind that the Bible explains that the ancient Israelites were held captive in Egypt, Assyria, and Babylon, but later their forefathers were abducted and brought as slaves to this part of the globe. This was not the manner in which those who call themselves Jews and other ethnic racial groups came to the Western Hemisphere, since they came here on their own free will. The scriptures proclaim that these curses will be so severe that it will be a wonder and a sign of who we are, the true children of Israel, and that these curses will be passed on to every generation forever. However, thanks be to Yah, we know that Yah will call Israel back unto himself and use a remnant, which is a few, to teach and awaken his children. Hallelujah. Deuteronomy 28:43. The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low.